Coming to you from the heart of the Diocese of Savannah, this is It's Catholic, Y'all, a series of conversations about faith and life. Views expressed in this podcast do not necessarily represent the views of the Diocese of Savannah.
Welcome to It's Catholic, Y'all. I'm Braylon Snow, and joining us today is Dr. Kent Lasnoski. Kent began his career as a professor of moral theology, focusing on marriage and family. He published an award-winning book, Vocation to Virtue. He and his wife, Caitlin, wrote 30 Days with the Married Saints, a couple's devotional and self-guided retreat. Over the last 10 years, he has studied, taught, and helped design curricula in the classical Great Books tradition as part of the renewal of Catholic higher education at Wyoming Catholic College. Now he brings that experience to the founding of a new Catholic college, the San Damiano College for the Trades. As president of San Damiano College, he lives in Springfield, Illinois, with his saintly wife and 10 children. Welcome, Kent.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
I'm glad you could join us. Well, you're here in Savannah today to give a presentation. You stopped by Benedictine Military School earlier and spoke to the boys there. And then tonight you'll be speaking at St. James Church. So for those who are outside of Savannah who might want to learn more about what we're going to talk about today, give us a brief overview of what this program is, who, what, where, all of that.
Sure. San Damiano College for the Trades is a brand new three-year associate's degree program in the Catholic tradition. The new thing we're doing is trying to connect people back to the dignity of work, right? So the mission of the college is to form men to recover the dignity of work and integrate it into the life well lived, right? The life for the kingdom of God and a life for the salvation of the world. So it's a really exciting mission. And the motto of the college is rebuild my church. So we're really trying to lean into that Franciscan tradition of trying to pick up the pieces of a church that has, you know, been wounded in so many ways over its existence and just needs restoration and renewal. A return to the beautiful traditions of the past, both liturgical, cultural, and intellectual. And ultimately, the traditions of the trades.
That's so beautiful. Share with us a bit of the origin of the college, including some of your background and how you felt called to found San Damiano.
So the deep origins of the school go all the way back to the Franciscan Brothers of the Holy Cross. They came from Germany over to Springfield, Illinois. In the late 19th century, they very quickly founded a Catholic trade school for young men, high school age, and it opened in 1929 and it closed in 1972. So for those 50 years or so, they were running strong and providing great training for young men who couldn't afford other schooling. Now, at the same time, on a campus right across the street, the Hospital Sisters of St. Francis owned and ran a mother house and a tuberculosis hospital. Okay. In addition to that, they founded a number of hospitals and indeed an entire hospital system in the Midwest. So as they have been aging, they've realized that that infrastructure needs to be repurposed. And so they've made it into a conference center and a campus. So between the campus that the brothers have, the old trade school, and the campus that the Hospital Sisters of St. Francis have, the conference center, we've got a beautiful campus all set up that we can use to continue the patrimony of those Franciscans, the Franciscan men and the Franciscan women. It's a beautiful opportunity. And thanks be to the Holy Spirit that moved those communities to welcome us and invite us. Also, we can give thanks to God for moving Bishop Papraki of Springfield, Illinois, to see the need for this school. He's really the one that's been kind of spearheading it. And he invited me into this project about a year and a half ago. So I was teaching at Wyoming Catholic College at that time and just kind of learning the Great Books tradition, getting myself deeper into that, learning about higher ed administration as well. And I had before that taught in Illinois at Quincy University, where I got to know Bishop Papraki. At that time in Illinois, I had already wanted to found a school. I knew that there needed to be serious renewal of Catholic higher ed in the Midwest. And I felt like this deep passion to be a part of that. But I didn't have any of the resources or anything like that. So God put me into Wyoming to learn those skills from a lot of great mentors out there doing amazing work. And then the Holy Spirit, you know, had Bishop Papraki give me a shout and ask me to discern this project with him. And it's just been great ever since then.
We kind of live in a unique moment in history. A lot of things happening educationally, mm-hmm. a lot of shifting around. I feel like, especially in the Catholic world, really taking a second look at education itself and as a country too. So what are some ways that this college is navigating those cultural shifts and in many ways rewriting the rules of higher ed?
Yeah, I'm glad you say that, rewriting the rules of higher ed, because there's so much dissatisfaction with higher education right now. And so we're trying to fix that problem, right? One of the rules of higher ed, supposedly, is you go in, you get a bunch of student loans, and you come out with $30,000 of debt. I mean, that's just an absurd kind of rule that we all assume has to be the case. So we're trying to rewrite that script and say, hey, what if we have young men that come in and they can actually work their way through this program? So we've got it set up so that students are working and making enough money in apprenticeships in the trades while they're in school with us that they end up making more money than the college cost over 3 years. So that's beautiful. That's one of the rules we're trying to break down. Another rule is to say, well, if you're in the manual trades, you don't use your mind. You're not a thinker, right? You could be a doer or a thinker. And if you're in the knowledge economy of higher education, then you're a thinker. But if you're a tradesman, you just, you know, you're interested in rock music and drinking beers on the weekends. You're not interested in the true, the good, and the beautiful. And that dichotomy is old and it needs to be done away with. So we're trying to form men to say, like, what? There's no reason we shouldn't have plumbers who are philosophers, right? The good life is the good life, and everybody should be invited into that. And ultimately, the good life is contemplation, right? Thinking about and experiencing contact with the things that are always and everywhere true, good, and beautiful. Nowhere else do we get that except ultimately in liturgy. So we have a real deep spirituality at the college, forming people with daily mass, spiritual direction, pilgrimages, retreats. It's just such an exciting time. So those are two of the main rules I think we're rewriting. You know, this assumption that doers can't be thinkers, and then this assumption around student debt.
And they're huge. So let's talk about the name a little bit and its significance. Brought in the San Damiano cross, which, you know, most Catholics have probably at least seen before and thought, mm-hmm. well, that's pretty. But for those who don't know the history, could you fill us in a little bit about that?
Sure. So the icon itself has a rich symbolic reference to it. And I'm not going to walk through that, but I will walk through the historical significance that it has for the school. So Francesco Bernardone, right? He's the son of a cloth merchant in Italy. And he is experiencing a conversion, right? This is St. Francis of Assisi, of course. And he's on his knees praying in a church, the Church of San Damiano. And this cross is there, the one that's right here in front of us. And in his desperate prayer, his not knowing what to do with his life, the Lord speaks to him. And the Lord says, Francis, rebuild my church, for you can see that everywhere it is falling into ruins. I mean, Francis is profoundly moved by this moment in front of this cross. And so he gets up and he grabs stones and bricks and he starts rebuilding physically a church. Now, that's amazing, but he goes on to discover that there's a more holistic sense in which God was asking him to rebuild the church, right? He's rebuilding the church liturgically, culturally, spiritually, with a renewal of religious life, with a renewal of getting back to the gospel as a rule of life. And so what we're doing at the college is we're taking those words, rebuild my church, as the sort of mandate. And we mean it just as broadly as St. Francis did. I mean, first and foremost, we're teaching people everything they would need, right, to physically build a structure like a church and maintain it. And then we're also teaching people how to rebuild and restore the liturgical tradition of the church by including students in the liturgical life of the Norbertine religious order, which serves as our chaplains. We're also teaching students how to rebuild the cultural element of the church, right, by teaching them the Western tradition of the intellect. And then we're teaching them how to rebuild the spiritual life of the church by preparing them to be strong husbands and fathers, leaders of their domestic church, or leaders of the ordained ministry, right, as priests. So it's a beautiful kind of holistic vision that we have.
That's great. So the school's going to be offering a unique combination of studies. So I'd like to talk about some specifics. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe not everyone listening knows what Great Books Program means. And if not, we can touch on that a little bit, as well as some of the skills-based things you're going to be offering.
Sure. So let's start with the Great Books. You know, we're used to thinking about and learning about history by reading a history textbook, where someone digests all of the various facts and figures and sets them forth for you in a narrative, right? Which is their approach to understanding what happened and why it happened. Now, that's all great, but it seems to me that the best way to learn about the world around us is to engage directly with the people, the thoughts, the realities around us, right? Instead of mediating that through other people, we can just engage with it as directly as we can. So the Great Books tradition of education is really based on that principle that we want to engage those thinkers, those beautiful pieces of literature as directly as we can. So in a certain way, instead of me being a teacher in the classroom, it's Aristotle himself who's teaching us in the classroom. Instead of me talking about theology, it's Thomas Aquinas, our friend, who's there with us, and we're talking with Thomas Aquinas about theology, right? So this direct approach. So that's what the Great Books approach is about. And we just kind of take that through history, theology, and humanities and learn about the deepest truths of humanity expressed in the greatest ways by the most profound thinkers. On the theological side, we give a real strong introduction to scripture. We read Old Testament, New Testament. We work through church doctrine, and we do moral theology, applied moral theology. And that's really a wonderful track. On the trade side, through the first year, it's this really exciting program where we spend 4 weeks introducing students to each of the trades. So you've got 7 4-week modules on the different trades. We've got carpentry, we've got plumbing, electrical, HVAC, roofing, masonry. It's an outstanding welding, right? It's an outstanding group of things. So we've got a lot of trade partners in town that are going to help us teach that and stock up our shops. And so through that process of directly learning with their hands and directly learning by meeting and having friendships with the great authors, they're going to have this exciting education that hopefully brings them to life in wonder and trains their minds to think well.
So who would be a good candidate for the program of those who are maybe coming to that point in their secondary school or even younger? Mm-hmm. I mean, who would be the ideal candidate to join? And then on the flip side, what's your portrait of a graduate look like? Mm. You've kind of already given us that end goal of what these men would be like, but the candidate portrait mm-hmm. of a graduate.
Yeah, I would say the good candidate is someone who wants to discern what their vocation is from God and wants to continue being formed in the riches of the Catholic tradition, both intellectually and spiritually and practically. So it's not someone who's just saying, I want to be a plumber and all I'm interested in is getting my plumber certificate. That's not really what the college is about. Nor is it someone who says, I just want the degree. I want some credentials after my name. It's someone who says, I want to learn and practice what it means to live a full human life. And part of that is using my hands and doing something beautiful for the Lord there. And part of that means thinking well and clearly, and not only just knowing how to build a house, but how to order that house once I've built it, right? And then someone who says, not only do I want to have clear thinking and do something good with my hands, but I want to be a saint. So I'm less interested in what you got on the ACT and more interested in whether you want to be formed ever deeper into your Catholic faith and ever deeper into the tradition of a trade, right? That's the candidate. I'm not going to use the word product, but the person who goes through this and is formed by it, man, I hope they're saints, right? Living saints. I hope that's really the main thing. But I guess what I could say objectively is that they'll be men of dignity who elevate the culture of whatever professional space they're in and who are ready to lead, whether that's in a domestic sphere or in a seminary sphere, and they're ready to keep up the habits of virtue that they've formed. Guys who are ready to launch, you know, ready to launch out there and do the job of the laity, which is to sanctify the world according to Christ the King.
Could a married man do the program too?
Sure. Yeah, there's no reason a married man couldn't.
Because they can't exclude, because they've found their vocation already, mm-hmm. I suppose. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's great. So what are some recommended resources, readings, or even life skills from the program that you would recommend to all Catholics, whether they get to be part of this or not? Mm-hmm. Yeah, some of your personal recommendations.
Oh, boy.
We already mentioned two guys to read.
It's an embarrassment of riches here for us. I would say Joseph Pieper has a little tiny book called Only the Lover Sings. And most people are familiar with his book, Leisure, the Basis of Culture, and they should be. But Only the Lover Sings is far more approachable, and it has a similar heavy-hitting distinction that he's drawing out about what is the difference between leisure and just recreation. And so the reason I bring that book up is because ultimately what we're trying to teach people is that the purpose of work is to make space for and prepare for and make possible leisure. And what do we know that leisure is? Well, if you look at scripture and you look at the tradition of the Catholic Church, you know that leisure is fundamentally worship. So like all of our work everywhere is really getting ready for worship and making worship possible in our lives. That's just kind of a cool way of thinking about it, right? Another person I would suggest is John Senior. So his Restoration of Christian Culture, where he asks and defines Christian culture. He says, Christian culture is essentially the mass and everything that goes into making it possible. Wow, like what an amazing way of thinking through the definition of culture. So John Senior and Joseph Pieper's Only the Lover Sings, two quick resources that I would suggest for everyone. A final quick third one, Matthew Crawford, Shop Class as Soulcraft. If you want a good perspective on what's happened to labor and work in the 20th century, it's an indispensable book to pick up.
So we mentioned, obviously, St. Francis. Who are some of your other saint favorites and why?
Yeah, my personal favorite saint, I would have to say, is Blessed Franz Jägerstätter. So I don't know if he counts as a saint yet, but Blessed Franz Jägerstätter. And for me, the reason is he's a perfect example of strength and fidelity and bold, courageous witness to the truth as a husband and a father. He was in Austria during World War II, and he had been conscripted, you know, drafted into the Nazi army, and he refused to swear allegiance to Hitler. Mm-hmm. And he did this. He tried to get out of it many times. Eventually, though, it couldn't be avoided. And everyone around him said, hey, you know, it's okay. You can do this. You can just say it and not mean it. But he had to be true to his conscience. He could not swear allegiance to Hitler. People even told him, well, what about your kids, right? What message are you sending to them? And you're going to leave them without a father. And his response really deeply moves me. His response was, what better thing could I do for my children than witness to them about the importance of the truth, right? And that I will never violate my conscience, whatever comes. So his martyrdom is just something that inspires me as a father and married man. Also, you know, I got to go with St. Joseph, the low-hanging fruit. I mean, for me, what's so cool about St. Joseph is he's a man that listens to the voice of God and does it, right? He listens and does it. In scripture, as you probably know, he never says a word. Totally silent. I'm a talkative person. I need to learn from St. Joseph, right? Hear the word of God and do it. What a bold man, right? I mean, what a gift that God thought he could entrust to St. Joseph purity and innocence itself in the Christ child and in Mary. So he was given custody over both of those people and to guard them and protect them in life. That's an amazing man. So we're blessed to have him as our patron in heaven. And so in fact, we even have a prayer for the college, which Yeah. Oh, yeah. Can I borrow yours? Sure. Yeah, I'd love to just go through that prayer right now and lift this time up to God, if you don't mind.
Absolutely.
Yeah. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Father and craftsman of the universe, in your wisdom, you called San Damiano College for the Trades into being, giving it the mission to rebuild your church and restore the dignity of work. In thanksgiving for your providence and recognizing our total dependence on you, we implore you to provide the resources necessary for the temporal and spiritual flourishing of these living stones you are setting in place. Bless and protect the students, guide the faculty and staff, and fill with every grace her generous benefactors. St. Joseph the Worker and St. Francis of Assisi, pray for us.
Amen. Well, so how can people learn more about the college? How can they get in touch with you if you're okay with that, to learn more? Where can they go to learn more?
Sure.
We'll link wherever it is on the show notes.
Sure. So you can go to our college website, www.sandamianotrades.org, and check it out. We have videos, we have podcasts, we have other radio shows that we've done. We have articles from other news places that you can read. The other thing you can do is send me an email. The easiest email is info@sdctrades.org, or just info@sandamianotrades.org. That goes directly to me. So you're going to hear back from me, and we'll be in touch about any questions you might have. We're going to have a visitors weekend in the spring, sometime in March. So we really hope to see anybody who's interested in learning about the college show up for that.
Because this is brand new.
Brand new.
So, well, great. Kent, thank you so much for your insights and for giving us just a little bit to go by and learn more. I'm very excited for you, and I wish you well in your endeavors.
Well, thank you so much for bringing me on. It's been a pleasure.
This has been an episode of It's Catholic, Y'all. Visit us at diosav.org or on our DioSav social media platforms for more.